There is a war raging across Africa. Casualties are mounting and injuries are becoming more severe.
I had a coma for 11 days.
But it's a war not fought on a battlefield. It's happening in the one place our children should feel safe and secure. In Kenya, corporal punishment's been banned in school for more than 20 years. But every day, our children are being beaten, all in the name of education. I want to know why this is still happening and what is being done to protect the most innocent in our society. My name is Tom Odula. I am a journalist, a broadcaster, and a survivor of corporal punishment. My school years were marked by brutal and degrading treatment at the hands of violent and sadistic teachers. Treatment that has stayed with me for life. Decades later, nothing has changed. Countless children are still suffering daily, as I did. I have come to Mombasa on Kenya's east coast to investigate a shocking incident that took place in a local primary school. This is 15-year-old Caleb Mwangi. He seems like any other boy his age, but looks can be deceptive. Last year, it's claimed Caleb nearly died after being viciously attacked by a teacher and a fellow student.
Lama.
Just because he wanted to eat.
Nilikuwa na njaa sana. Nikaenda kuchukua chapati tano. Nikakunywa na chai.
Caleb says his school director, Nancy Gachewa, found out about the chapati and punished him with a beating. Saidi, whose real name is Eid Salim, was an older student. Allegedly, he was told by the director to carry on beating Caleb, which he did brutally and viciously.
Kufika kule, huyu hangeweza kutoka kitandani, hangeweza kuongea. Kampeleka hospitalini. I had a coma, yakapelekwa ICU for 11 days.
Huyu tukiwa hospitali, ndiye huyu anaoshwa. Alikuwa hivi mwili mzima.
Caleb had nearly 100 lash marks on his legs, and the wounds on his back were so severe he had skin grafts.
Sasa unaona, sasa nyama zilikuwa zinatolewa huku, 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 huku. Zinakuja zinabandikwa huko.
Nancy Gachewa and student Eid Salim were arrested and charged with assault causing grievous bodily harm. Salim was sentenced to 4 years imprisonment and in a plea bargain is testifying against Nancy Gachewa.
Kijana akasema hapana, mimi nataka kurudi upande wa kale niseme vile kulikuwa. Tulipewa idhini na director tupige Caleb na tumuue.
The fate of Nancy Gachewa, who denies the charge, saying she had nothing to do with the beating and wasn't even there, is expected soon. But no amount of justice is going to take away the trauma Caleb is suffering.
Mimi nikikumbuka huwa basi nasikia hasira sana. Nikikumbuka hata basi zingine basi na kunja ngumi. Nagunga ukuta.
Ni nini ungetaka ifanywe ndo huu upate haki?
So mimi ningetaka justice yangu ipatikane. Huyo mama afungwe. Mteremkie hapa. Mbona nimwambia hivi kila
mara? It's absolutely shocking that Caleb was beaten to near death. Apparently because he was hungry and was asking for food. The physical injuries he has exhibited can only be compared to pictures I've seen of whippings during the slave trade.
And to think this was allegedly done to him, over 50 shillings worth of chapati. It's unbelievable. The sad thing is that Caleb's case is far from unique. Officially, corporal punishment in schools was outlawed in Kenya in 2001. But over 20 years since the ban was put in place, the practice is still happening.
You only have to go online to see how many videos and news reports are being uploaded, showing how prevalent corporal punishment is in Kenya, and in fact, the whole of Africa. I mean, these things are being posted on a weekly basis.
Seeing these horrendous images takes me back to my childhood and what I went through at my old primary school. Happy recollections of friendships, but also painful memories of corporal punishment I received through vicious beatings. When I was growing up, I had no one to turn to. But today, victims of school beatings can get help from the Teacher Service Commission, or TSC. The TSC manage all aspects of the teaching profession in Kenya, including investigating incidents of corporal punishment. Their staff are told not to speak to the media, but one person wanted to talk to me on condition of anonymity. They are extremely worried about how big an issue corporal punishment is in Kenyan schools.
So the TSC is concerned about the rise in corporal punishment. The cases are on the increase. It's getting more severe now than it was before, because you find teachers beating children up, physically beating.
According to our source, the number of reported cases has increased by over 300% in the last 3 years.
It is becoming a crisis, and actually, it is being discussed because we feel it's going out of hand now. Cases of children being injured and maimed. Some of these cases have resulted into very severe consequences, even death.
I know the situation in schools is bad, but hearing that children are dying really shocks me. One victim of corporal punishment who was allegedly killed by a deputy principal is Abby Samuels.
This is a sports certificate. She was an athlete. She was the best girl in sports.
Abby died in 2019. It's claimed after being hit while at school. Martha is Abby's mom.
Friends wrote her small little notes. This one says, "We'll always bring a smile."
Abby's school claims she died in her sleep, but witnesses say she was beaten by the deputy principal because of the way she wore her hair. Martha demanded an autopsy, believing the beating led to Abby's death.
The autopsy report revealed that she had severe head injury, secondary to blunt force trauma. So somebody hit her to cause that kind of an injury to her, leading to her death.
But even with all this evidence, it took several years to get the case properly investigated, which Martha believes was because of a cover-up.
So why do you think it took so long?
They were trying to force me to believe that my child fell from a bed, and that's why she died. She had a blood clot.
Justice for Abby!
Eventually, after years of campaigning, trying to get to the truth, Martha took matters into her own hands.
That is when it gained momentum. That is when investigations started afresh.
I hope to get justice for my child. That's where my focus is. Don't get me wrong, they are good teachers. I had good teachers, and I had bad teachers. The bad ones really need to pay.
Justice for Amy!
The killing of Abby, allegedly at the hands of her deputy principal, is far from unique. Over the last 5 years, more than 20 deaths linked to corporal punishment in schools have been reported in the media. Countless more highlight beatings which have led to severe injury. And even as I am making this film, I'm tipped off about another horrendous case in the west of Kenya. I'm in the countryside to meet the parents of a girl who was apparently badly beaten by a teacher to the point where she was hospitalized. Asante. The girl is 16-year-old Safin Marutu. Her parents, Regina and George, tell me what happened.
Kuna mtihani yenye walifanya na kupata max ile ilikuwa inatakikana. Sasa mwalimu alimwambia lala chini. Utapata kiboko kwa zile umeangukia. Vile alikuja kunieleza, juu aliogopa nitamuogombesha kwa nini au kupita mtihani.
Safin was in agony for 3 days, but said nothing until her mom spotted something was wrong.
Sasa kutoka shule, amebeba bag, naona natembea na vuruta mguu hivi. Mwalimu amenichapa mgongo, mpaka nikaona damu sahizi.
Safin was eventually taken to hospital by her teachers, where x-rays revealed the full extent of her injuries.
Inaonyesha ni?
Hii x-ray, inaonyesha mgongo hapa. Wakamuambia unaona hapa, imepigwa na kitu ingine.
So the doctor's report says it's blunt force trauma that caused the back pain.
Blunt force trauma means an injury caused by forceful impact, a fall, or physical attack.
Kiaje kama wazazi, kujua kuwa kuna mtu, mulipea mtoto, awachungie na wamuelimishe, alafu sasa mtoto amerudi akiwa kilema.
Tunasikia vibaya kabisa.
Mimi hapa nalala nikisikia hiyo mambo ya kule.
The family only have a small plot of land and struggle to afford proper treatment.
Unaweza kumbuka hiyo siku uliumia? Nini ilifanyika?
Tulipewa mtihani to nikafail. Hivyo ndio alituchapa kukuja kwangu. Ndio akanichapa kiuno ikaumia.
Huyu mwalimu mshai kuwa na ashai kuchapa mbeleni? Kuchapo ni kitu ya kawaida hiyo shule.
Watu wa wanachapanga.
Safin's adamant she was hit by her teacher. A claim backed up by 2 students who say they know what happened. I arranged to talk to them, but fearing repercussions, they hide their identities.
Nini ilifanyikia Safin ndo akaanza kushindwa kutembea?
Alipigwa na mwalimu.
Saile Safin alichapwa, mliongea naye baada ya kuchapwa?
Tulizungumza na akaniambia anahisi mgongo wake hauko sawa.
The second girl echoes what the first one says.
Lakini wewe uliona mwalimu akichapwa?
Ndio, tuliona.
Alikuwa anachapa kiaje kama umeanguka?
Ukianguka alichokufunza anakupiga.
Safin's friends are positive the teacher beat her. But what does the school's headmaster say? After all, he's the man who's supposed to oversee all his teacher's behavior.
Corporal punishment is a crime. That crime happened here, under your watch.
It happened in class and I was in the office.
So you bear responsibility for the welfare of all the children here?
We don't allow. You're seeing all these books. Yeah. They bear the regulations over which we are working.
Then I learn something that surprises me.
The teacher was drinking so much. I've really tried to nurse him, working with him for almost 5 years. was not easy. And many times we collided.
On what issues, basically?
Behavior. Caning the children is one of them. Drunkenness is one of them.
With the caning, how many complaints did you receive about him?
There were many.
Mr. Airo has admitted that Sefrin was indeed caned here, leading to the injuries that she's suffering from. But instead of taking disciplinary action against the teacher, he was transferred to another facility where he could possibly be meting the same kind of corporal punishment on other students. The testimonies I've heard all suggest the teacher did beat Safin. I need to hear his version of events. So track him down and confront him with what I've been told.
Did you cane her on the day she claimed that you caned her? Is that true, at least that part?
I can't recall
caning her. You can't recall caning her. But then the headmaster, when we talked to him in school, he said you actually caned her. So where did he get that report from?
I really don't know. Because she was talking in my absence.
Two girls who are with Sefrin in the same class, who say that on that day, what happened is they failed to reach a certain quota of marks and the whole class was caned. But Sefrin especially.
I never caned Sefrin.
Mm-hmm.
I never caned her.
Do you understand that caning in schools was banned?
I completely understand.
And do you adhere to the ban
of
caning in schools?
Yes, I do adhere to.
The teacher is adamant he didn't beat Sefrin. He also declined to comment on the other claims the headmaster made about his behavior. But there is no denying Sefrin did suffer an injury to her back while at school. It saddens me that decades on from the beatings I received at school, children are still experiencing the same trauma. Back then, I was on my own, but today there is some hope. And it comes from the Beacon Teachers, an organization championing the rights of children and preventing violence in the classroom.
I know you've heard stories of people saying, oh, an African child has to be beaten, an African child learns through the skin. All these are just theories.
Across Kenya, there's over 3,000 of these progressive Beacon teachers. Robert Omwa is one of them. He used to beat his students, but today is spreading a message of non-violence.
As teachers, we are making a deliberate effort to move from that cane method of disciplining children. Indeed, violence against children is illegal, but sometimes that's the only method that we know.
I dropped the use of cane. Nowadays, I just talk to them, guiding and counseling them in case of anything. I want to thank, and it has really helped me a great deal, and it has also helped the teachers.
I want to learn more about this new approach, so I meet with Robert at the school he used to teach in.
Hi, Tom.
Hi, how are you?
Welcome to Thimbonde Primary.
Thank you very much.
Karibu sana.
Asante.
Yeah.
In your days in class here, how did you administer corporal punishment?
I used the cane a lot. At some point, I would ask the students to kneel down. But basically, I used the cane. And I can show you how we did it. Okay. Yeah. We would use anything that looks like a stick. So this roller would do. Okay. So basically for boys, we would hit them on the butt.
Like,
so
that's like,
yeah, and then you'd hit them on the butt. Whoa. And then for girls, they would stretch their hands and we'd hit them on the hands. Pop, pop. No way.
Yeah, and sometimes it would break.
It breaks a lot. Maybe this one broke when such a thing was happening.
Okay. Yeah, that brings back painful memories and moments of being scared.
It's surreal because I'm in this school and this is where I used corporal punishment. And this is the same school where I stopped using corporal punishment. And the moment I saw the light was after using the cane. I would go home feeling very unhappy, having inflicted the pain.
And this was when he decided to become a beacon teacher.
A beacon teacher is a teacher who looks out for the rights of children. So initially I was skeptical about it. I thought this is Western ideology, African child has to be beaten. But when I tried it, I felt relieved as a teacher. I felt lighter. I felt the children gravitating more towards me.
Robert still admits there's a lot of work to be done.
It's almost 20 years down the line since corporal punishment was banned. The teachers have been left their own devices. You're not told if it's
this
illegal.
This is the alternative.
What are you supposed to use? I would say it's still very prevalent. Still very prevalent. Because it is deeply ingrained in teachers.
Robert's doing his best to spread the idea that corporal punishment in schools is wrong. But what are the authorities doing to help the victims of this appalling violence? We requested an interview with the Ministry of Education, but nobody was willing to talk to us. From what I've seen, Kenya's corporal punishment ban is in name only, with victims like Safin having to find their own justice. Her former teacher is still claiming his innocence. So Safin's brother, William, has been trying to get help from the local TSC office. But this is proving difficult.
Wakati vile Safin alikuwa mgonjwa, sasa tulijaribu kwenda kwa TSC ili nisikie ni la yao. Vile wanaweza tusaidia na kitu watafanya, watafanya mwalimu. Jambo, which option they will take to the teacher. Vile tulienda huko, wakaniambia wanataka hawezi fuatilia huyo mwalimu bila TSC number.
The TSC number is unique to every teacher and identifies who they are.
But can the TSC just check the teacher's name?
Alikata hiyo. Aliniambia nirudi tu kwa mwalimu na niandikie letter.
William feels he's being given the runaround and nobody is willing to help him.
Vile wananizungusha, nikienda TSC office, wananituma kwa head teacher. Nikienda kwa head teacher, ananituma kwa mwalimu mwenye alichapa selfie.
What does this make you feel or think?
Jakuwa nikiona vizuri. Juvile nilitoka huko, keshowe, nikakutana na head teacher na huyo mwalimu mwenye alichapa selfie. Wakiwa bondo. Sasa nikuwa najiulize. Ah, watu, ni kwa nini wanatembea hivi na alishani nyima nini? TSC number.
The head teacher denies being obstructive to William and says he's not friends with the teacher. But the family have lost faith in the TSC and have turned to the police to get justice for Safin. According to our source at the TSC, their experience is not unique.
So many times, by the time the case reaches us, it is already totally diluted. So much evidence has been corrupted. Sometimes we cannot even get a hold of the witnesses. But I'm thinking it all begins in the grassroots level. There are cases down there that are killed there, which do not even reach us here. They never see the light of day.
We asked the TSC to respond to all our claims, but didn't receive an answer. But there are a few successes. And after years of fighting for justice, matters finally had a breakthrough. Elizabeth Wairimu Gatimu, the former deputy principal accused of killing Abby, is in court today charged with murder. She denies the charge, saying she wasn't at school when the incident happened. Kiroko Ndegwa is the lawyer dealing with this unique case.
A teacher who allegedly used corporal punishment leading to a death of a student. How rare is it for them to be prosecuted?
This is the first case I've seen. It is the case that shall set that precedent on how we deal with alleged instances of corporal punishment.
It's a hard day for Martha. I can't imagine what she's going through, reliving the trauma of her daughter's death.
It's not easy.
It's not easy.
To relive these things afresh and on a day that is the day my daughter died, it's actually today, 8th of March. So me sitting in that courtroom and everything just playing back in my mind was really making me angry. It hurts, but that today is four years since my daughter died.
Elizabeth Wairimu Gatimu's fate is currently in the hands of the judge. In the meantime, all Martha can do is wait for the justice she's been fighting for.
I told myself, I will not be silenced. I will not keep quiet. I will not give up fighting. Maybe the day I give up is the day that I sleep like my daughter. But as long as I breathe, I will not give up. I will do everything that I have to do as long as I'm alive to ensure that justice is served for my child.
It's been more than 20 years since corporal punishment was banned in schools. But from what I've seen in the last few months, this barbaric treatment of our children continues unabated. If parents, teachers, and ultimately the authorities don't do more to stamp out this practice, then our children will continue to be maimed, traumatized, and even killed.